Welcome back to my channel. So today we are going to study Organism and Population, Chapter 13 of Biology Textbook 12th. Now let's first understand the word ecology. Ecology, logy means study. So it is a branch of biology which mainly involves the study about the interaction among the organism and their environment. In the environment which they live, it's an interaction between them. So basically there are four levels of biological organization. First is organism, population, community, biomes. So let us study the organism, organization and population in detail right now. So let's see what is organism. An organism refers to a contiguous living system, that means continuous living system, that lives in an environment and has the ability to adapt and retain certain structure and behavior. So it includes fungi, bacteria, plant, animal and humans. Okay, an organism collectively forms a population. So as you can see, individual forms an organism. So many individual come together, they form a population. So here there is one fish. In population there are groups of fish. And population forms a community which operates the ecosystem. So along with this fish, now comes the water and the grass and all the living organisms which are present. Now this forms a community. The ecosystem consists of both biotic and abiotic factors. Biotic factors means living organism and abiotic factors means non-living organism. So abiotic includes soil, water, and biotic includes fishes, different types of fishes, and also the grasses, leaves, and plant which are present in the water. Now whole this forms an ecosystem. Major abiotic factors which leads to variation in the physical and the chemical condition of different habitats are temperature, water, light and soil. Now let's see the relation between the organism and environment. So all organism possesses the ability to adapt to the different environmental condition due to the genetic variations. So this increases the chances of survival. That means if they will adapt to the surrounding, they will survive. If they don't adapt, they will get extinct. So the example is the polar bear has different characteristic traits that help them to adapt to extremely cold climate of Antarctica. The dense fur coat protects them from the cold and predators. The waxy coat repels water and keeps the body warm. As you can see over here, this fairy clothes which coat that they have developed on themselves. This feature helps them to adapt to the cold region. Now, let's see what is a biome. So, a biome is a community of plants and animals. So, it includes both plants as well as animals that have common characteristic for the environment they exist in. So, for example, take a desert region. So, where camel, which is an animal, and cactus, which is a plant, they both have a same characteristic feature for the environment. That means they have the potential to retain water in them because there is lack of water in the environment. Okay, they can be found over a range of continents. So biomes are distinct biological communities that have formed in response to a shared physical climate. So as I told you the example of desert, you can keep that in mind. So annual variation in the density and the duration of temperature and perceptions are responsible for the formation of major biomes. So as you can see, when there is more rainfall, there is a farm formation. When there is less rainfall, there is desert formation. So accordingly, there are six major biomes. So first is Arctic, where there is snowfall, then coniferous forest, temperate forest, grasslands, tropical forest and deserts. So these all are known as biomes. Now let's see what is habitat. So a place or a part of an ecosystem occupied by an organism is known as habitat. And what is niche? Niche is nothing but the role of an organism within its environment or the ecosystem. So habitat includes only the physical place, that means where they live, and niche includes function or the activity of that organism in that environment. So habitat includes reflects the living place of an organism, and niche includes reflects its biotic and abiotic association with the environment in the terms of its diet, reproduction, and other activities. So let's see an example. So it's a frog. So its habitat is in present. They are present in the wooden region and in wetlands. Their behavior is often found in the trees and can burrow. They feed on small insects eaten by birds, snakes, and raccoons. An impact on the ecosystem is they limit the insect, aerate the soil, and serve as food sources. So this all behavior on which they feed on by they are eaten and impact on the environment. This four becomes nightshade, and this is the habitat, that means where they live. Now, nightshade are of two types. First is fundamental or hypothetical, which means that the organism does not have any competitor. This is actually not possible. So let's come on something second part, which is known as realistic or actual. So the portion of the fundamental nightshade that the species actually uses. Species never lie under perfect condition, but where an acceptable ecological sum of condition exists. That means they have the ability to adapt to the surrounding and live. Now, let's have a look on abiotic factors. So the most important abiotic factors of the environment are temperature, water, light, and soil. Biotic factors are the pathogens, parasites, predators, competitors, etc. Now let's see the abiotic factors first. So first comes the temperature. The physiological function and the geographical distribution of the organism is governed by temperature. Okay, so temperature affects the kinetics of enzymes, basal metabolic rate, and other physiological actions in an organism. Now what is eurythermal? A few organisms which can tolerate wild range of temperature are called as eurythermal organism. That means they can accept extreme cold condition also and extreme heat condition also. Stenothermals are many organisms which can tolerate narrow range of temperature are known as stenothermal organism. That means they have the capacity to tolerate only cold or to tolerate only heat. Now, second important abiotic factor which comes is water. So, what important factor influence the life of the organism? The productivity and the distribution depends upon the water. For aquatic organism, chemical composition, pH, salinity, and temperature of waters are important. So, eurohaline, that means the organism which can tolerate wide range of salinity. Salinity means the level of salt in water. Are called as eurohaline organism. They can tolerate wide range of salinity. That means even if the level of the salinity is low, they can survive. Even if the level of the salt in the water is high, they can survive. And then comes the stenohaline. The organism which can tolerate narrow range of salinity are known as stenohaline organism. Moving on to the other type of abiotic factor, that is light. It is an important abiotic factor because the autotrophs, that means the plant, prepare its food by photosynthesis. Now there is something which is known as schizophytes. So small herbaceous plant and some shrubs live under the canopy forest trees are adapted to photosynthesis under very low light intensity. These are known as schizophytes. So for example, so you can see over here, these are the canopy trees which are long and inside them are present small herbs and shrubs and they required only low light intensity as they are covered by long trees. Animal uses the seasonal variation in the light intensity and the photoperiod as clues for the timing of forage. That means they will move out from their shelter in the search of the food, reproduction, and migration. So if the region is very cold, they will move to a region where there is a warm climate, and when the warm climate increases very much, they will again move to a cold climate where they were present earlier. The distribution of red, green, and brown algae at different depths of water depend upon the light. Red algae can live in very deep water. Moving on to the other type of abiotic factor, that is soil. So nature and the properties of the soil depends on the climate, weathering process, etc. The physical and the chemical properties of the soil determine the type of plant that can be grown in the particular habitat. So for example, if you will say you want to grow an apple in Mumbai, it won't be possible because it requires that property of soil which is mostly present in snowy areas or in Kashmir. The characteristic of the bottom sediments of the aquatic environment determine the type of benthic animals that can live there. That means benthic animals means the inside deeper animals where they live. So it depends upon the characteristic of bottom sediments that they contain. Now, how organism responds to environment? So there is something which is known as regulation. So organism maintain hemostasis in constant body temperature and osmotic pressure. So for example, humans, even if the temperature is very high or if the temperature is very low, our in the environment, our body temperature remains constant because hemostasis is maintained in our body. Now there is something which is known as conformation. So majority of the animals and plants cannot maintain a constant internal environment. Such animals and plants are simply called as conferers. So their body temperature varies according to the ambient temperature. Ambient means the surrounding temperature. Their body temperature will vary. In aquatic animals, the osmotic concentration of the body fluid varies with ambient water osmotic concentration. Thermoregulation is energy expensive process. Heat loss or gain is a function of surface area. Therefore, small animals are not found in polar regions. Okay, so their temperature will keep on changing according to the temperature which is present in their environment. Now the third type, which is migration. So organism can move away temporarily from stressful condition to another habitat. This is known as migration. So as you can see over here, if the region is very cold and they cannot bear, they will migrate to the other area where the temperature is warm, and when the summer season comes, they will again come to the original area where they were belonging. Now the other type is suspension. So organism that cannot migrate suspend their metabolic function during stressful period. It is known as suspensions. That means they won't carry out any metabolic functions like reproduction in that period. They will suspend or they will go under dormant state. Now the examples is hibernization. So in hibernization, it's a process by which the animals avoid the stress and becomes inactive during winter. So for example, polar bears, frogs, lizards, they become inactive. Now estivation. So estivation is a process by which the animal avoid the stress and summer related problems and become inactive during summer. So for examples are snails and fishes. Also, they have the property of adaptation. So adaptation is any change of the organism that can be morphological, physiological and behavior that enables to survive and reproduce in its habitat in the environment which they live. So adaptation has evolved over a long period of time and are genetically controlled. So examples are desert plants have thick cuticles on leaf surface, so there is loss, the water loss is prevented. Shrunken stomata, leaves modified into spikes. Due to CM pathway photosynthesis, the stomata remains closed during the day. And these examples are cactus and Optia, etc. Now let's see the what are the adaptation aquatic plants have taken. So they have evolved erichema, that is nothing but air cavity for buoyancy and floating. So leaves have waxy covering also. As you can see over here, they can float because of the erichema that they have. Desert animals, kangaroo rat living in the desert of North America never drinks water. So the water required is by internal fat oxidation, in which the water is the byproduct. So this byproduct water is sufficient for the kangaroo rat. It is also available to concentrate its urine so that the minimal volume of water is lost during excretion. So they are able to concentrate its urine. Now, according to Ellens, there is a rule which states that animals from colder climates generally have shorter ears and limbs to minimize the heat loss. In polar seals have a thick layer of fat below the skin that acts as an insulator. It reduces loss of body heat. Short ears and limbs minimize the heat loss. Now moving on to the second part of the chapter, which is population. So population is defined as group of individual or organism of any species living in a well-defined geographical area at a specific time with the capacity of interpreting, that means to reproduce. For example, population of deer in forest, as you can see over here. So this becomes a population, which means group of organism of individual of any species living in a well-defined geographical area. That means here the geographical area comes the forest at a specific time with the capacity of interbreeding. With the capacity of interbreeding, that means they have the capacity to reproduce. Now let's see what are the population attributes. So first is birth rate, that means the total number of individual born in a given period of time. It is also known as natality rate. Death rates, that means the total number of death in a period of time, which is also known as mortality rate. Then comes the sex ratio, so the total number of females and males per 1000 individuals. Then comes the age pyramid, a plot of age distribution. So the lower contains the age group from 0 to 14, the middle part contains from 15 to 45 years of age group, and above contain 45 to 85 plus age groups. Now the left side is contained male and the right side contains female. So the shape of the pyramid reflects the growth status of the population, that is expanding, growing population, a stable population, and a declining population, as you can see over here. So in the first graph, as we see, the graph is expanding. That means the age group from 0 to 14 are more, then the age group from 15 to 45 are less, and the age group, that is the old age, which is declining. In the second graph, what we see is the graph is static. That means a slow growing. That means the age group from children's age group is not expanding as much as it was expanding in this rapid growth, and the graph is static. Now the last one, which is known as declining, in which what we see is the age children's are less as compared to the middle age group, and the last age group are more in comparison to this both age groups. Now let's see population growth. So population growth refers to the increase in the number of individual in the population. Increase in number of the individual in the population, it depends upon the various factors like weather, food availability, predator, pressure, etc. Okay, so the population density changes due to the following factors. First is natality, that means the number of birth in the population in a given period of time. Mortality, the number of death in the population in the given period of time. Immigration means the number of individual who move to some other habitat in certain period of time. And immigration, which means the number of individual who have came into the habitat from elsewhere in the certain period of time. So all these factors influences the growth, population growth. So if the natality is high, population will grow. If the mortality is low, that means the death rates are low, population will grow. Immigration, if it is low, then the population will grow in that area. And if immigration means number of individual coming to into the habitat in a certain period of time, if there are more individual, the population will grow. As we discussed earlier, that is about population growth. So size of population keeps on changing with time depending upon the factors like food available, weather, predators, pressures, and competitions. The natality and the migration contributes to increase in size and density of the population. So they are directly proportional to increase the population growth, and mortality and immigration contributes to decrease in population. So they are inversely proportional to it. So the equation which is formed is NT is population density at a time, and O is population in the beginning, plus in the bracket comes birth rate plus immigration minus death rate plus immigration. So this forms a formula for population density at a time. So how much population is present at a time, this will be the formula which is used. Now there are growth models. There are two types of growth models for population to determine the population. So first is exponential growth model. So what happens is when the resources are available in unlimited in the habitat, that is in the given area, the population grows in an exponential or a geometrical fashion. So if resources like food, water is available in plenty, then there will be increase in growth. As you can see over here, this is the graph. Then comes the logical model, growth model. So no population can continue to grow exponentially as the resources availability becomes limited at a certain point of time. So there will be decline or decrease in the growth rate, and this is known as logistical growth model. Population interaction. So living organisms interact in various ways to form a biological communities. So there are two types, interspecific interaction and intraspecific interaction. In intraspecific interaction, it is an interaction of population of two different species. So for example, take a fish having an interaction with a plant, so or eating a plant. So this forms an interaction between two different species. An intraspecific interaction, which means it is a interaction of individual of the same species. For example, two fishes having interaction between their own self. Now the interaction of different species have different types. So first is predation, second is competition, parasitism, commensalism, amensalism, and mutualism. So now let's study individually in detail. First, let's see what is predation. So it is an interspecific interaction in which the predator, which is a stronger animal, kills and consumes prey, which is a weaker animal. Therefore, the one species is benefit and the other is harm. So here we can take an example of tiger, which is a stronger animal, eats deer, which is a prey, which is a weaker animal. So predation is always transfer the energy from lower tropic level to a higher tropic level. So lower tropic level over here is deer, and the energy is transferred to the higher tropic level to the tiger. Predators keep the prey population under control, otherwise prey reaches very high population density and cause imbalance in the ecosystem. Okay, sometimes predators are used as a biological control for pests. So for example, you can have a ladybird are used to control aphids, and dragonflies for mosquitoes. So dragonfly eats mosquito and the mosquito's population is kept under control. Now what happens is, as we all know, survival is to the fittest. So prey species have evolved various defense mechanisms to reduce the impact of predation. That means to fight against this predation, they have undergone some mechanism, some defense mechanism. So for example, certain insect species and frogs have camouflage, that is cryptotic coloration. As you can see over here, this is a frog and it has got the same color of the wood or the surrounding, so that the predator gets confused whether the frog is present or not. So this is evaluation. It is known as cryptic coloration. Now let's see the second example, which is monarch butterfly, which is very distasteful to its predator bird. This is because it secretes a special chemical in its body. So this chemical, which is released, forms a protective or defense mechanism against the predator bird, which makes it distasteful, and hence the monarch butterfly are protected. Now moving on to the plants. So herbivorous, which are the animals or insect which eat plants, are known as herbivorous. As plant cannot move, it becomes more difficult them to survive. But then too, it has developed some mechanism. Let's see what mechanism plants have developed. So these have developed certain morphological and chemical defense mechanism against herbivorous. So for example, thorns and spines, which are produced, so the insect or the animal does not come and eat them. Now certain chemicals are produced by the plant which acts as a defense. So Calitropus produces a highly poisonous glycoside, that is a cardiac poison. So it kills the herbivorous animals. Nicotine, caffeine, quinine, strychnine, opium, etc. are the chemical products by the plants against the herbivorous. So these are the chemicals which are released and the morphological changes, which is thorns and formation of spines. So competition. Moving on to the second type, which is competition. It is an interaction among the individual of same species, that is intraspecific, or individual between the individual of different species, which is interspecific. Competition between the individual of same species is for the same resources that are limited. So for example, two tigers are fighting for a same food which is limited. In some cases, resources needed not be limited for competition to occur. The feeding efficiency of one might decrease due to the interfering of the other. For example, tortoise in island became extinct within a decade, that is in 10 years, after goats were introduced into that island. So it was due to the fact that the goat had greater browsing efficiency than the tortoise. Unrelated species, for example, flamingo and fish, also compete for same resources, that is for zooplanktons. Now, there is one principle which is known as Gauss competitive exclusion principle. It states that two closely related species competing for the same resources cannot exist together, and the competitively inferior will be limited by the superior. Okay, so for example, you can take of cheetah and tiger or lion. Both are closely related species which have the same resources, and the tiger or the lion, which is superiorly, will compete the inferior one, that is cheetah. Resources partitioning. It is a mechanism meant for coexistence of species to face the competition. So according to this, if two species compete for the same resources, they could avoid competition by choosing different times for feeding or different foraging patterns. That means they can change their food. Now the third one, which is parasitism. So it is an interspecific interaction where one species, which is a parasite, depends upon the other species, which is host, for food and shelter. So host gets harmed and the parasite gets benefit. So for parasites are the host specific, and parasite and its host needs to co-evaluate. That means what? It means that if the host evolve a specific mechanism to reject or resist the parasite has to evolve the mechanism to neutralize them. Which means that if the host is trying to resist the parasite has to evolve so as to get neutralize the mechanism in which the host has evolved. So parasites' adaptations can be due, like it may lose sense organs which are not important, and it may increase its high reproductive capacity. It may there may be presence of suckers or hook to suck the blood, and loss of digestive system as they directly get nutrition from the host cells. So for example, you can have an example of human licks and ticks are ectoparasites. So they are present in the human's hair and they suck the blood from the head. Then second example is copepods are the ectoparasites on some marine fish. Cuscuta is a parasitic plant that grows on the trees or shrubs. Some parasites have complex life cycle and generally have one or two intermediate hosts. So for example, you can take a malaria parasite has one intermediate host, that is mosquito, to spread to the another host. And human liver fluke have two intermediate hosts, a snail and a fish. Now this intermediate host acts as a vector which facilitates parasitism of host. Matlab, it will transfer it to the host. Now the third type, which is mutualization. It is an interaction, interspecific interaction, in which both the species of interaction gets benefited. So for example, lichens are relationship between fungus and algae. So an association of fungi with roots of higher plant, fungi helps to absorb nutrition from the rocks, and the plant provides energy yielding carbohydrates to fungi. So fungi helps to absorb nutrition to plant, and in return the plant provides energy yielding carbohydrates to fungi. Plant depends on insect for pollination, and in turn they give them nectars or pollen to eat. Animals help the plant in seed dispersion, and in turn they give fruits to animals as food. Okay, so this is mutualization. Both get benefit. Now the last one, which is commensalism. It is an interspecific reaction in which the one species gets benefit and the other is neither harmed nor benefited. So for example, epiphytes, that is orchids growing on the tree bark, as you can see these orchids which are growing on the tree bark. So this orchid get benefited, but the tree bark does not get benefited nor it gets harmed. The second example is the clownfish living along the sea anemones, as these are the clownfish. So the clownfish gets protection from the predators. Suckerfish on the back of the shark. Thank you. Hope you like this video. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe, and share your views in the comment section below. Till then, bye.